Good evening. Hope you guys appreciated my solo singing there. I was singing in the background, enjoying the music and the worship. Just want to give a quick update on a couple things. Sunday drive-through service was fantastic. It was perfect weather. I appreciate all you guys coming out. And some of y'all sat out in the lawn chairs. Some of y'all dropped tailgates. Some of y'all stayed in the car. But it was a really, good, comfortable day. And if we look at the weather right now, it's going to be comfortable again this Sunday. So invite a friend out. One thing, as we get closer to opening the church up, we need some cleaning supplies. I kind of put a plea out last week or two on the emailing list, and I didn't get a chance to say anything about it Sunday. So I got 1 gallon of Lysol somebody dropped off with a spray bottle with it. But as we get closer to opening up the church, we're going to need some Lysol, some cleaning supplies to operate the church. So if you can, if you find it, please, we'll reimburse you as a church, or if you want to donate it, that'd be great to get us in a position to be able to open the church back up. Hopefully it'll be soon. We don't have no idea when that's going to be. So just be in prayer for that. And except if you pass by an aisle and you get to see some cleaning stuff, just grab it, throw it in there, and we would appreciate that. Just a couple prayer requests. Amelia and Andy Adams were definitely diagnosed with COVID. They're doing well right now. They don't have very small symptoms, but they've been diagnosed with it. So be in prayer for them and their family, and Roger and Stephen as they're with them as well. So obviously they're in the quarantine. Feel free to call them and tell them you're praying for them. Tonight we want to look at, I just wanted to kind of jump into a segue from Sunday's message about what Satan can't do. And, you know, I think as Christians, we're in a battle. There's no question that we're in a war against Satan, who's our enemy. And I just want to look at some scriptures tonight about how Satan's at war with us. And when we understand how Satan operates and the way he operates, God gives us wisdom. He gives us wisdom to move away from some of his traps, some of his temptations. And tonight I just want to look at a few things and a few ways that he still wants to operate in our lives, and how we can help defeat some of the ways he operates in our lives. If you have your Bibles, I'll ask you to open them up to Ephesians chapter 6. Obviously, we're going to look at some other scriptures as well. And I try to keep this thing between 35 and 40 minutes, 45 minutes, the best I can. I don't want to rush it, because I think this is some important scriptures and some important things. And if we get to 35, 40 minutes, whatever, I'll just cut it off, and we'll pick it back up next week as well, because this is a really good, it really helped me study. So let's open up in prayer. Father, I just thank you and I praise you, Lord, for the day you've given us today, Lord. I pray and lift up Amelia and Andy, Lord, and their family, Lord, as they're going through this trial, this battle, Lord. That Father, that they'll come through it great in 14 days, and they'll be off of anything, Lord. And right now they're feeling well, and we can thank you for that, Lord. But we're asking you for a special touch for that family, and we thank you for the blessing of some other ones that had some medical issues this week, Lord, that you've seen them through as well. And Father, we just want to ask you to keep our family safe. And Lord, we know that you're a God that's in control of everything. But Father, we desire and long for wisdom and things that we need to know, things that we need to understand, Lord, and things that we need to deal with. And so, Father, I just ask you to speak to us tonight through these scriptures and show us, Lord, that there's a way out every time that we have trouble or calamity in our lives, Lord, that you have a reason for it, and there is a way out, Lord, and you've given us this Bible, Lord, to show us and instruct us how to do it. So Father, tonight I ask you, Lord, to just separate our minds and our hearts just for a few minutes to be able to hear from you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You know, God has so much to say about how Satan operates and how he's always scheming in our lives. And never in the Word of God, and I mean never in the Word of God, do I see anywhere, Old Testament, New Testament, do I see anywhere that we're to be afraid, that we're to be fearful, that we're to live in fear of what might happen, in fear of what may happen or what may not happen. And God reminds us constantly through Paul and Peter and other scriptures that we'll look at tonight. He reminds us constantly that we need to be on guard, that we need to be aware of his ways and be ready for Satan as he attempts to attack us and as he will attack us. And we need to be on guard for that. So God has a purpose and a plan. Obviously, we see that through the scriptures in our lives and all of our lives. And the enemy also has a plan like we looked at this past Sunday. But God has a purpose. And we have to determine in our lives as Christians, we have to determine and we have to choose who we listen to, what voice we're going to listen to, who we're going to choose, who we're going to choose to follow. And we get to make that choice. And God gives us that opportunity to make a choice of who we're going to follow and who we choose to listen to. And in the battles that we are facing today can make us fearful of tomorrow. We can be scared of what's going to happen tomorrow. And because, you know, truthfully, scriptures tell us, and everybody else tells us, that we have no clue what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. And here might be a shocker for somebody tonight. The government has no idea what tomorrow is going to bring. Our local officials have no idea what tomorrow is going to bring. Our doctors don't have any idea what tomorrow is going to bring. The only person who has any kind of clue what tomorrow is going to bring is the Lord. So, you know, watching the news every day ought to remind us that our government is not in control. God is still in control. And you know, looking at not having any control over tomorrow, it should make us sometimes fear a little bit of what tomorrow is going to bring, fear of some of the what ifs. And some of those what ifs start stacking up on us. You know, what if I get sick? Or what if the, and all that stuff starts stacking up on us. And listen, I believe with all my heart that Satan has gone to war using this virus. I mean, he has really gone to war through our minds, through our news outlets, through our government, through our local officials. He has really gone to war through this virus. And never in my life have I seen strong Christian men and women come to such brink of utter fear, living in complete fear of what might happen or what if this happens. And you know, we're to obey our government. We're to obey our leaders. And in other words, we're to do the right thing. You know, wash your hands, wear a mask, wear gloves, stay home, whatever it takes. But don't live in complete fear. Stop living in complete fear. Living in complete fear absolutely shows a complete lack of trust in our God. Do the right thing and trust God's going to take care of us. You know, if the good Lord intends for us to catch this virus, you know, there is nothing. Bubble wrap, shrink wrap yourself, hide yourself in a closet. You know, drive out to the middle of the river. There's nothing that's going to stop you from getting this virus if God desires you to have that. So Trump says all the time that we're fighting an unseen enemy. And for a Christian, you know, we can say we've been fighting an unseen enemy ever since we've gotten saved or before that, because we know that Satan is unseen. We can't put our hands on him. So we face that unseen enemy ourselves. And man, I would love to for Satan to be in a human bodily form so we can take him out back and put our hands on him. But we're fighting that unseen enemy. We can't see him. So unfortunately, we can't do that. But Christians, it's so easy for us to lose focus in and on our problems and on our issues. It's so easy for us to get distracted and get off the beaten path with God. But the truth is, there's spiritual forces that are battling for our minds. They're battling for our homes. They're battling for our kids, our families. They're battling for our marriages. They're spiritual forces that are battling in the churches. Every Sunday when we're out there trying to set up for Sunday morning drive-through service, trust me, there's spiritual battles going on Satan does not want us to meet out there in that parking lot. He doesn't want us to have this Bible study tonight, especially about him. So there's spiritual forces that are at work. And listen, just like this hidden virus that causes us so much sickness and is causing so much destruction, is causing so much disease, that's exactly the way Satan works. That's exactly the tools that he uses and how he operates. So today might seem scary. It might seem difficult. It may even seem discouraging, but we don't have to let him win. One thing about it, I'm not going to live my life in complete fear and let this virus or Satan steal my joy of being with my family, being with my church family, being able to do this tonight with Braden, to be able to do our drive-through service out there. You know, I'm not going to let him steal that kind of joy from our hearts. So in every battle, a good soldier must know who his enemy is. He must know what that enemy is capable of. So when we understand how Satan operates, we'll have the wisdom and the courage to be able to move away from those traps. And God and this Bible has so much to say about his schemes and how he operates. And again, I'm just going to go back and say, if I'm wrong, please prove it to me, where it shows us to be afraid, for us to be living in fear. I'm going to give you some scriptures tonight that tell the complete opposite about how to live our lives, and especially through this virus and trials and storms in our lives. So let me say this, and I'll move on. If we feared God the way we fear this virus, I believe we'd have a great revival. I believe we'd see a great awakening in our churches, a great awakening in our world. Revival would break out if we feared the Lord as much as we fear this virus. Now, that's my PSA for tonight. I'll move on to biblical things here. So God reminds us again to be alert, to stay on guard, that he always has our back. He's always with us. He's never going to leave us. He's never going to forsake us. We heard all those scriptures, but do we apply them to our hearts? Do we listen to what he's trying to tell us over and over and over again? Or are those just words to us that we speak or say? And here's some ways that Satan's at work through this virus tonight, how he tries to bring defeat to the believer, how he tries to bring defeat to us every day. So I'm going to go through seven things, and if we get through tonight, fantastic. If we don't, that's good too. We'll be able to pick this back up again. You know, I was having a conversation with somebody today in my office, and I'm just curious now. When you guys we were talking about having a captive audience. Like tonight, you guys are watching this. And to me, it seems, I was reading an article from another pastor where he posted, and he said, seems like we'll probably lose some attention of the listeners because they're at home and they're going to get up and use the bathroom. They're going to get up and get coffee. They're going to get up and get a drink, whatever it might be, and they're going to get distracted. So I'm just asking you, if you're distracted tonight from trying to hear this word, this message, pause it, whatever, you know, come back, listen to the words, because I believe in my heart that Satan doesn't want you to hear what this has to say. Anytime we meet together, anytime we open up the Word of God, he doesn't want us to be to hear that. So if there's any distractions in your way right now, please try to set them aside as we open the Word up tonight. So number one, I want to look at he's trying to consume us in doubt and fear and worry. He's trying to consume us in doubt and fear and worry. You know, the devil, one thing about the devil we see throughout the Word of God, he's not stupid. He's very smart. He's very deceiving. Master manipulator. He will always make lies sound like truth. And we can't fall into that trap. And this is, again, I'm just getting off the path just for a second. That's just like listening to the media. Every station you listen to is going to be different. You know, you can listen to CNN, you can listen to Fox, you're going to get different news reports, you know, but we have the choice of what we need to hear for truth. But Satan's always going to make lies sound like the truth. So don't fall into those traps. And listen, he hasn't changed his ways since Genesis. Almost 3,000 years ago, you go back to the Bible, he hasn't changed his ways, the way he operates, the way he works. He's working the same way. You go all the way back to Genesis 3:1, the serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals the Lord God had made. And one day he asked the woman, did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden? Here it is. Like I said, almost 3,000 years ago, he's shrewd. He's questioning. He's making us doubt. He's making us think about things. So, you know, how do we carve through his craftiness and his lies and his deceit? You know, how do we know when he's trying to manipulate us, like he was Eve here? And how do we put a stop to it? So first, I want to say this to you. It's not easy because, again, he's smooth. He's shrewd. It's not very easy to understand or know when Satan is manipulating us or when Satan is lying to us. But it requires some work on our part as Christians. So, and again, we got to understand that we're not fighting against one another. We see battles, internal battles in the church. We see internal battles against Christian. And we have got to understand what the Word of God says, that we're not fighting a man or a woman in humanly form. We're fighting spiritual forces. And when we get to understand that, I think we'll be more forgiving to one another. I think we'll be more gracious to one another because we're not fighting against each other. Listen carefully what Paul says in Ephesians 6, 10 through 12. He says, the final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. We can't be strength. We don't have any strength in our own power. This is what Paul's saying. But be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand against all the strategies of the devil. Now, I want you to really catch this now. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood. You understand that? There's nothing humanly formed here that we're fighting against. You know, we're not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, and against mighty powers in the dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. See, again, we're not fighting flesh and blood. We're fighting spiritual wars. We're fighting spiritual battles that are in the unseen world, things that are going on behind the scenes that we don't get to see. We don't get to know. So remind yourself when you think you're battling someone in the church or you're battling another Christian, we're not fighting against flesh and blood. We're fighting against unseen, evil, spiritual rulers. So keep that in mind. And Paul is giving some final words to us here in Ephesians, what he's saying here. But, you know, there was another scripture. I didn't get a chance when I was restudying this. I want to go on and read verse 13. I left it off. And it said verse 13, it says, for this reason, take up the full armor of God, that you may be able to resist in the evil day, and having prepared everything to take your stand. You know, we got to be prepared for a battle. It's not if, but when that battle comes. So we got to be prepared for when that battle comes. And from what I read and from what I see, we cannot fight Satan on our own. Satan has the power to overtake us. He has the power to defeat us by ourselves. We're going to see that a few minutes in the scripture. But two things every Christian has. We have the Lord and we have each other. And if you're not using both of those, Satan could easily take us out. We need to be using the Lord. Lord's on our side, and we need to be using one another. There's nothing wrong with asking for help, especially spiritual help, from somebody else. That's a great thing to ask somebody to pray for you. It's a great thing to ask somebody to come and help you. And I often say all the time, you could be robbing somebody else of using their gift to be able to help you, whether it's prayer, whether it's just whatever it is you might need. So use those two things all the time, the Lord and each other. So number two, we see where he's the master of destruction. Our scripture in the sermon this past Sunday, the Lord just really laid on my heart about worry and anxiety and Satan these past few weeks. And But I want to reiterate that scripture that we use Sunday, the thief's purpose. Again, Satan has a purpose. His purpose in life is to steal, kill, and destroy. Doesn't say his purpose is to pluck your nerves. Doesn't say his purpose is so that your car won't start tomorrow morning. It doesn't say that your kid's going to back talk you tomorrow morning. That's not Satan's purpose. His purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. God says his purpose is to give us a rich and satisfying life. So we see what his purpose is. You know, a lot of times we'll say to people say all the time, well, I'm under satanic attack. I'm having a bad day. You know, you could just be having a bad day. It had nothing to do with Satan. Don't give him the credit, because he wants to come in and steal, kill, and destroy. And he's going to be relentless in trying to rob us of our joy. And that's what I see mostly through this virus. I see the Christian's joy, this spark in their life, has been defeated in fear. And that's where Satan is attacking us the most. And as Christians, you know, I can't reiterate enough. Read the scriptures about fear. Just put all your worries and anxieties and fears into his hands. But he's going to be relentless in trying to steal our joy, trying to steal our peace, our security, our purpose in life. And if he attacks us in these areas, and that's what he's doing right now, I believe he's attacking hard in these areas of our lives. But if he attacks us in these areas, you know, we're always going to be left discouraged, defeated, and discontented, especially when we're not using the Lord and we're not using each other to help fight these spiritual battles. And he works hard at attacking what we love the most. He works hard at loving to attacking our families, attacking our lives, attacking our kids, our grandkids, and everything that we love the most. He's going to want to try to attack that, take that from us. And that's why we need to stand together. We need to be united in prayer for whatever it is that we're going through. We cannot defeat Satan on our own, but there's power in numbers. You know, we can get him to run. Scriptures tells us how to do that. And Ecclesiastes really was telling us in the scripture that I love. I don't think people really understand it fully, but in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, it was talking about power in numbers. It says, two people are better off than one, for they can help each other succeed. If one person falls, the other person can reach out and help. Love it. Love it, love it, love it. Every single Christian, from time to time, slips, falls, get off the beaten path. Man, if you got another Christian that's faithful to you, he can reach down and help you. It says, but someone who falls alone is in real trouble. You know, we see Christians that come to church for years and years, and all of a sudden they just fall away. I mean, I don't understand it. I wish I had a reason why they fall away from church. Or fall away from the Lord, mostly. I mean, sometimes I can understand why they fall away from church sometimes, but how they fall away from the Lord and their relationship, I'll never understand that. But it says somebody who falls alone is in real trouble. In verse 11, it says, likewise, two people lying close together can keep each other warm, but how can one be warm alone? A person standing alone can be attacked and defeated. He's making it very clear. You know, we can't defeat Satan on our own. He's making it crystal clear here. A person standing alone can be attacked and can be defeated. But two can stand back to back and conquer. And three are even better, for a triple braided cord is not easily broken. I know you guys have heard that scripture many times. It's an awesome scripture. And you know, a lot of times when I'm fighting these spiritual battles in my life, sometimes I'm a little standoffish. I don't want to tell people what's going on in my life. I want to handle it myself. What a mistake, according to scripture. What a mistake. You know, find somebody you trust, rely on them, talk to them, pray with them. Scriptures tells us, man, we can be taken out. If we're alone, we can be taken out. So I hope that scripture helps you. Number three, he tempts us to rely on ourselves. You know, again, like I was just saying, Satan wants nothing better than for us to fight him one-on-one. That's what he wants, because he knows we have no chance one-on-one. We cannot take him out one-on-one. So he wants to try to take us out in our own strength. And why? There's a reason why. The reason why he wants us to fight one-on-one, the reason why he wants us to be alone is because he knows our weakness. He knows where we're weak at. He knows one-on-one we don't stand a chance. And alone, he can take us down. So he'll do anything to try to lure us away from the truth, to try to lure us away from God, to try to lure us away from one another. And I believe this virus right now, again, he's already got us lured outside the church. This could be a great thing for us to be reestablishing the church. I don't know. But it definitely is a distraction for the church. But he's luring us away from godly things. And he's going to tempt us every time in our weakness. And once we slip and fall into one of his traps, he's going to do whatever he can do to hold us down or to keep us down. So, you know, we all look at Satan and we see the Hollywood version of Satan, the demon, the devil possessed, the red suit, the horns, intimidating, demon, scary, evil. And he is. That's maybe might be a description of him, but he will and does make himself look beautiful. He's attractive. He makes sin look good. He makes sin look alluring, enticing. And it's just this, he puts things into our minds all the time, plants these seeds into our heads and tries to justify things like he did back in Genesis 3:1 with Eve. You know, surely God didn't say for you to eat the fruit. That's exactly what he does to us. You know, it's just this one time. It's going to be okay. Just this one time. Everyone understands it's going to be all right. You're allowed to sin every now and again. You know, you're not as bad as everybody else. It's okay. Nobody will ever see it. Nobody will ever know. You know, enticing words, smooth, elegant words. And if Satan would tempt Jesus, if he would tempt Jesus, what makes you think that he wouldn't tempt us? I mean, obviously, if he's going to tempt Jesus, he's going to tempt us. He says in Matthew 4, verse 3 and 4, during that time, the devil came and said to him, if you're the Son of God, tell these stones to become loaves of bread. But Jesus told him, no, the scriptures say, people do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. I want you to notice something about this scripture. This Satan attacked Jesus 40 days out in the desert. He has not eaten in 40 days. He's out there in the desert. And what does Satan tempt him with? Bread. Let me tell you something. Have you ever smelt hot bread coming out of the oven? You know, a little slab of butter on that thing? That's tempting. That is tempting. But he knew where to attack Satan. He knew exactly where to attack him. He tried to attack him at his weak point. But if you notice through the scriptures, you go back and read the scriptures in the New Testament, he didn't come to Jesus until he thought he was at his weakest point. Again, he's cunning, he's smart, he's wise. But when Jesus was healing people and he was casting out demons and he was teaching in the temple, and you didn't see Satan come and try to take him on one-on-one. You didn't see that. It didn't happen. He waited for him to get alone. He waited for him to get weak, and then he attacked. Keep that in mind. When we get alone, we're by ourselves. I mean, that's when Satan's going to start planting things in our head. But that's what he waited for when he attacked Jesus. So he waits for us to get weak. He waits for us to lower our defenses enough to where we entertain what he's saying, enough to where we'd be able to listen to what he's planting in our minds. Because, you know, again, we got this picture of Satan, and that's not the biblical picture of Satan. We look at that demonic voice or that demonic evil demon, but scripture says the way he looks, it says in 2 Corinthians 11:14, but I'm not surprised. Even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. Again, smooth, cunning, pretty, crafty. He looks good. So don't be taken by surprise by this Hollywood planning this evil-looking, demon-possessed person. He disguises himself as an angel of light. Number four, He is the author of confusion. He'd like nothing better for us to live in distrust, paranoia. He's a deceiver. He's going to bring confusion into our lives. He's going to bring confusion into your family's lives. He's going to do whatever it takes to lead us astray. And the Bible says, again, going back, the Bible says he's a sheep in wolf's clothing. He's a liar. He's the father of lies. He works overtime to make sure, to make us try to doubt God's word, to doubt his truth. And from the beginning of time, all the way back in Genesis, he lied and twisted God's word, and he brought about doubt. He brought about disbelief. And again, his purpose is to lead us astray. His purpose is to get us away from church, to get us away from one another, to get us away from our relationship with the Lord. So we got to be very careful. Look what it says in Revelation 12:9. The great dragon, the ancient serpent, was called the devil, or Satan, the one deceiving the whole world, was thrown down to the earth with all his angels. The one who was deceiving the whole world. That's his job. He's to deceive us. He's to try to make his lies seem like truth to us. So always remember, again, he's the father of lies. In John 8:44, for you are the children of your father, the devil, and you love to do the evil things he does. He was a murderer from the beginning, and he's hated the truth because there's no truth in him. And when he lies, it is consistent with his character, for he is a liar and he's the father of lies. That's his character. He's a liar. He's a deceiver. Again, just remember, that's his character. That's who he is. So a lot of times, Satan's going to come in and he's going to do whatever it takes to confuse us, to cast doubt, to cause us to doubt things, cause us to doubt our relationship with Christ, cause us to doubt our salvation. That's his job, to cause confusion. And when you're confused and maybe things are out of order in your life and you're messed up and you don't have any goals, you don't have any commitment to the Lord, I want you to know that those things are not of God. God's got a plan for our lives, you know, and we need to just surrender to that plan, have peace in that plan, have joy in that plan. But when you're out there and you're lost, you know it in your heart. You know you're off the beaten path. You know when you're going the wrong direction. It's easy to tell. He says in 1 Corinthians 14:33, for God is not a God of disorder, but of peace, as in all the meetings of God's holy people. Again, God's a God of order. He's not a God of disorder. So if you are confused and you're doubting your salvation, you're doing all those things, you know, you need to sit down and talk with somebody and try to get yourself back on the path. Because again, Satan's going to do whatever he can do to distract you from your relationship with God. And number five, I kind of like this one. He always tries to get us on the slide. He always tries to get us on the slide. And the slide I'm talking about only goes one way. If you've ever ridden on one of those slides, you know which way it goes. Slide only goes one way. That's straight down. And once you're on it, you know you go faster and faster and faster, and you get out of control sometimes, and you're confused and you're doubting. But if you don't get off that slide, eventually you're going to hit rock bottom. Eventually you're going to hit bottom, and that's going to be a bad place for you. And Scripture tells us in Peter that Satan's prowling around like a roaring lion, seeking who he can devour. So keep that in mind. His attacks are ruthless. They're relentless. He searches for the weakest first. He searches for the most vulnerable, and sees who he can devour. And I often say, that's why we need to protect and pray over our family so much, because if Satan cannot get to you, he might get to your husband, he might get to your wife, he might get to your grandkid, he might get to your son or your daughter. You know, so we need to be in constant prayer and praying with one another, because he's going to try to take out the most vulnerable or the weakest first. And that's why we often see when people get discouraged, discouragement often leads to depression. Because we're getting on that slide again. We're going down that downward slide, that downward path. And Satan, once he's got you on that slide, away from God, he tends to give you that push and makes you go faster and faster and faster down that slide. And that's his desire. He wants you to be on that that slide. But at some point, we got to do what the scripture says. We got to resist him. We got to stop. We got to think, this is not right. I'm going the wrong direction. Something's not right in my life. Something's not registering right. I don't feel joy. I don't feel passion for God. You got to get off the slide. You got to get off that slide. And it may be painful jumping off that slide. But God promises. He promises to catch us. He promises to hold us. He promises he's got our back. But you got to, it's your choice to get off that slide. You have to get off it. And we have to choose to get off it. That downward spiral. And listen, Peter knows all about fighting the enemy of confusion, the enemy of disorder, the enemy of discouragement. And man, he's messed up so many times, and he knows that Satan had talked to him before. But listen to what he says in 1 Peter 5:8. He says, stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for somebody to devour. Peter knows what he's talking about. He's been there. He's done that. And he's telling us, be careful, stay alert. And again, that we're not alone in the battle. Again, we have two people in this battle. We have the Lord and we have each other. And remember that. Number six, he causes sickness and disease. God allows Satan to run the course here on earth. You know, he's in charge down here right now, but he does not have authority over Jesus. He's in charge here, but he doesn't have authority over Jesus. And the Bible calls the devil or Satan, he calls him Beelzebub, which is the Lord of the Flies, or Prince of Demons. And we see where he's ruthless, he's evil, he gravitates towards death and decay and darkness. And his intent is to bring suffering and destruction and chaos and separation and confusion in our lives and in our churches and in our relationships. And there's a story in Matthew where a demon-possessed man who was blind, he couldn't speak, and they brought him to Jesus, and Jesus heals him. What an awesome picture of somebody coming into our church. They're blind, they're demon-possessed, they can't speak, and you lay hands on them, Jesus lays hands on them, and now he can speak. He can see. He's not demon possessed anymore. And the Pharisees come along, and they're about to lose their mind. Their minds are blown. How could he do this? This is what the Pharisees want to know. How could he do this? And maybe he's a demon himself. That's what the Pharisees were thinking. That he was that Jesus was a demon casting out demons. Look what he says in Matthew 12:24-26. But when the Pharisees heard about the miracle, they said, no wonder he can cast out demons. He gets his power from Satan, the prince of demons. Again, no doubt in my mind, Satan had planted those thoughts in the Pharisees' mind to be able to think this way. And they said, Jesus knew their thoughts, and he replied, any kingdom divided by civil war is doomed. A town or family splintered by feuding will fall apart. And if Satan is casting out Satan, he's divided and fighting against himself. His own kingdom will not survive. I mean, it's crazy talk to think Satan's going to cast out Satan. And it doesn't even make any sense. Jesus knew that was their thoughts, and he quickly cleared that up as well. So lastly, number seven, I promise to be within... I'm a little bit over, but we're going to get through this. Number seven, he works at division. Satan would like nothing more than to shut the doors of the church the way they are right now. He wants us to fight each other. He wants to ruin our testimonies. But he's the one that will hinder anything that we want to do for God. He wants to put that stumbling block in our way. He wants to try to disrupt anything that's God's will. And he's going to throw all kinds of stumbling blocks at us. And we see that all the time, where he throws these stumbling blocks. And he'll do anything to stop the very name of Jesus being proclaimed, being worshipped. You know, I'm sure that he's laughing that the churches are closed right now, but we're probably reaching more people now than we ever have before through Facebook, through YouTube. my gosh, the drive-through service, we probably almost had 90 people show up this past Sunday. That's a great Sunday for not even being in the church. So God's put it right back into his face, I guess what I'm trying to say. But he's going to do anything to stop us from worshiping him. And he'll use all kinds of tricks and temptations to put roadblocks in our paths to stop us from being fruitful or doing any kind of discipling. He loves to stir up troubles and rumors and gossip. And he can divide us through disunity. But he knows when he does that, when he does divide us, he knows that he's won that battle. But look what Paul says in 1 Thessalonians 2:18. We wanted very much to come to you, and I, Paul, tried again and again, but Satan prevented us. Satan put roadblocks in Paul's way. He wanted to get out there. Satan kept putting these roadblocks up. So every time we slow down or hinder the gospel work, you know, we possibly could be a stumbling block ourselves. You know, if God tells us to do something, we shouldn't let anything get in our way, anything to stop us from achieving that. Matthew 16:23, Jesus turned to Peter and said, "Get away from me, Satan." Boy, that stings if you're Peter. That really stings. He turned to Peter and said, "Get away from me, Satan. You are a dangerous trap to me. You are seeing things merely from a human point of view and not from God's." So Peter was humanly thinking and was being a stumbling block and trying to get God's will and God's work done. So remember, we got a choice who we listen to. We have a choice of who we follow. We have a choice of who we believe. And we have to push past his lies. We have to step over those stumbling blocks, those traps, and we have to resist them. God gives us the power to fight Satan, and it's called the Holy Spirit. We have to rely on that Holy Spirit and rely on one another. He gives us wisdom. He gives us discernment to know what's right, to make the right choices. And I'm going to leave you tonight with one last scripture in Ephesians, where Paul says, what Paul says he's leaving with too as well. In Ephesians 6:10, the whole armor of God, put on the whole armor of God, a final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Guys, again, we cannot fight Satan on our own. We have got to use the Lord and use one another. He gives us these tools. If we're being taken down by Satan, we can pretty much say it's our fault because we didn't use the tools or do it the way God told us to do it. So, you know, if you feel like you're going the wrong path tonight, you feel like you're distanced, you're lost, call up somebody. Call your pastor up. Call me. Call your Sunday school teacher. Call Michelle. Call somebody that you can talk to and get yourself back onto the right path with the Lord, because we don't want you to be discouraged or defeated in any kind of way. I know being stuck at home is mind-boggling sometimes. People want to get out. But again, I'm going to go back to telling you, do the right thing. God's going to be there for us in the end. Last, I just want to remind you, we'll have another drive-in service Sunday at 10 o'clock again. Looks like right now it's going to be great weather again. I'm kind of enjoying the outside. It sounds like some other people are enjoying the outside too. Be able to set up your lawn chair, drop your tailgate, and just enjoy God's creation. Again, service is usually running 35, 40, 45 minutes at the most. So, because we know people had to drive in from other places. We'll have some special music again. Somebody will sing and a song. But most of all, we get to be together. If you have any kind of prayer request, please, you know, use ColerainPraysForYou.com or call me or text me, private message me on Facebook, because we want to pray for you. The deacons have a prayer chain. We call around, we text each other on a prayer chain. So if you have something that you need prayer for, please let me know. So thank you for tuning in tonight and listening to me ramble on for 45 minutes. But thank you, and I appreciate what you guys are doing. Appreciate the encouragement coming out to the drive-in services and the things that we're trying to do to make things more normal. As we fight this, we'll fight it together. Remember to pray for the Adams family. Keep them in your mind. So let's go ahead and close tonight in prayer. Father, I just thank you and I praise you again tonight for giving us another night, Lord. It was created by you. And Father, we just ask for forgiveness of our sins, Lord. We ask you to help us and to remind us, Lord, not to rely on our own selves, Lord, and to rely on you and each other, Lord, that we have, that you put other people on our path, Lord, that we can talk to and we can share with, Lord. And so, Father, I pray for encouragement for the ones that are discouraged right now and the ones that are fearing things that are going on, Lord, that you'll put some joy back into their life, Lord. And so, Father, I pray for Miss Amelia. I pray for Andy, Stephen, and Roger, Lord, if they don't have it or haven't been diagnosed with it. But, Father, I ask you to protect them and that family, Lord. And Father, as a church family, if we can help them in any way, I pray that we can be able to do that. So Father, help us to be encouragers. And Lord, most of all, Lord, we just thank you for getting us through another day. And we'll give you all the glory in what we've said and done today. In Christ's name, amen.